The Dubai World Cup Carnival is one of the most lucrative racing circuits on the planet. And may I suggest that most South African racehorse owners would dearly love to have a runner during that particular carnival. And of course, it culminates on the 26th of March for the World Cup of Racing, which is run at Maidon Racecourse for a staggering $30 million United States dollars. And guess what? Charismatic entrepreneurial trainer Paul Lafferty has a runner in Harry's son. And Michael de Kock, who's been the flag bearer since 2002, has got seven runners who will compete on Dubai World Cup night. During a recent visit, Mike de Kock was out in South Africa to check up on his South African operation. We were able to catch up with him and find out what he thought about his season, and also to find out what he thought about his runners on Dubai World Cup night. But one of the most important aspects of this broadcast, which Teletrack has been bringing you for the past decade and a half, is the fact that we've got a brand new sponsor in SAP. They're a company that analyzes information, millions of gigabytes of information that are at your fingertips for the purpose that you desire. And it is a great honor to have them on board. And whilst we are looking at the form of the Dubai World Cup for 2016, we're going to have a chat to Mike de Kock to see exactly how he thinks his runners will perform. Most importantly, Mubtahij, who runs in the $10 million Dubai World Cup, 2,000 meters. He has to take on a horse called California Chrome. He has to take on Frosted, and he has to take on a whole lot of very special racehorses who are keyed for the dirt. Here's Mike de Kock to talk about his season during the 2016 Dubai World Carnival.
No, we've had a good season, Andrew, don't get me wrong. There's a few horses that I think that will still fire. I'm hoping for a good World Cup evening. I'm not saying that they horses that will win on World Cup, but they'll be very competitive on World Cup night. A lot of them are peeking into the race at the right time. You can see with a few of the horses that didn't fire last year that it sort of did quite well this year. So it's never straightforward.
Yeah, I think the horse that that would have immediately spring to mind has got to be Forry's Waltz, but we'll get to him in due course because the UAE Derby is the race that you have been most successful in. I mean, it was absolutely scintillating last year with Mubtahij and, of course, Asiatic Point to mention, but two, and they are both particularly relevant to this discussion. Let's talk about this filly who's been far from disgrace, running behind an absolute superstar in the Oaks, and she's your representative in the UAE Derby this year.
Yeah, she's well above average. She had a very early poor start to the season. She just kept on going wrong on us. She's now sounded up. She had done quite a lot of work going into the last start, but I mean, we'll improve with the run as well. She was beaten by a very good filly that they were talking of taking to the Kentucky Derby, etc. And I feel if we went another 100 metres, I think we'd go past her because I'm not convinced that she was running to the line, that filly. I think we had a chance of beating her.
Yeah, of course, as you made abundantly clear earlier on in the season, the Dubai World Cup is run on the 26th of March and that's what you're aiming at.
Yeah, well, it's always got to be your mission. You get your carnival horses and you get your World Cup night horses. And, you've got to try and have them ready for that night if they're good enough. Others, you've got to get in and get what you can during the carnival. So sometimes it's a bit of a juggling act.
Is she right up there with the best fillies you've trained of her age?
She's right up there with the good fillies I've taken to Dubai. She shows us plenty. She gives Christoph a very good feel. Obviously, she's very comfortable on the dirt. But she is a group winner on turf as well. She's a very smart filly, and I'm hoping that she's going to be right on the night. It's a second run back. It's not ideal going in, but it's the cards we dealt. We're going to have to deal with them.
Does anybody ever know if a horse likes the dirt or likes the grass? They can't talk to us, but you can see by their form. Obviously, there's a serious kickback. And it's about how you get covered from that kickback because no horse, I'm sure, likes getting sand kicked in their favour.
Oh, absolutely. You've got to get a good position early, otherwise you're done. And, you can see really, really good horses run motherless in races when they don't get a good position early because they're taking in all the kickback and they're not able to breathe. And when you scope them afterwards, they are just choked with sand. I mean, bordering on being cruel in a way. When you see these horses afterwards, how full of mud they are and how they are coughing and battling to breathe, you can't tell me that that is that's kind to horses. I can't buy that.
And Old Star Empire is starting to flash right down the centre of the track as El Lavelle got a split in the middle, and it's Star Empire and El Lavelle, the carnival stalwarts. Star Empire, El Lavelle, Star Empire on the outside. The old boy's done it.
The Gold Cup, it's a race that started off with teething problems, but I guess it's probably one of the best surfaces you can ever race on. And you've got one horse, he's getting on in years, but he's as consistent and he's as loyal as the day is long. And another horse that seems to have progressed to a trip where he shows that he might well be effective in Tallina.
Yeah, Tallina ran a very good race last time. He could conceivably have been second or third very easily. Ryan Moore rode him and was adamant that he would have been in the first three. And in fact, asked for the ride in the Gold Cup and said, that I should be running the horse. He stays very, very well. He's got an above average cardiovascular. His heart rates are very much of a horse that's going to stay all day. And that's why we tried him over ground. He was running okay over 10 furlongs, but he was just not that quality. They were a bit too strong for him over 10 furlongs. But over 2 miles, this horse has actually got a bit of a chance. And I think if you look at his form as well, that every time he went more than 10 furlongs, he ran crackers. He was finishing very, very well. So, I think the signs are there that he would stay.
Star Empire, is there much to add? Is he just continuing this lease of life?
Yeah, he's very well in himself. 9 years old, it's not, easy to predict what they're going to do. But he's very happy, very sound at the moment. I would hope this is his last year. I don't really want to carry on running him. I don't think I've ever run a 10-year-old. I don't really want to start running 10-year-olds.
Sure.
I think he deserves a good retirement, actually.
And he's owned by one of the nicer men in the game. He will make sure that the horse has a good home once it's done.
100%. No, he'll retire to Sheikh Mohammed's palace farm in Dubai and live out a very pleasant life.
Fountain Gel put his head in front of Battle of Marathon. Furry's Waltz but pounced on the outside, went to his stable companion. Furry's Waltz took the lead. 100 left to go. Furry's Waltz in front of the El Rashidir. Fountain Gel battles back, but the South Africans are 1, 2, and 4 in the end.
Right on to the turf, or formerly known as the Duty Free. You've got one horse that just continues to improve with each and every run that he's had. And of course, a horse in Ertegel who really was, besides being a Group 1 winner in South Africa, a horse that always looked like he was going to be a better four-year-old.
Yeah, two nice horses. A horse like Forrest Waltz was unbeaten at two, and certainly if we had left him in South Africa, he would be competing with Legal Eagle, and he'd be sort of a horse, if I was in the Met, I'd expect him to be running in the first three. He's that sort of quality. I'm not sure that's good enough to win the turf race. It's a hell of a strong race. The horse of Charlie Appleby's, hell of a good horse. It's a very tough division. I think if we run third or fourth, it'll be a huge run with both of them. Ertegel ran very well last time. I still think he hasn't been ridden correctly. Everyone thinks that he's a front runner. He's not necessarily a front runner, this horse. He went to the front and won the Derby, but because the hack in Cape Town, they don't go any pace at all. But in Dubai, there's no free leads, so... He's done it the hard way, and I'd like to see him just get led into the straight by one or two, because he does have a finish on him. So I'm hoping Hannigan will ride him like that in the Duty Free, and he'll be a better horse for it.
Well,
I haven't had him spot on yet, to be honest. I think he's a horse that's really sort of coming good now.
Yeah, look, the time that they met when Forrest Waltz was victorious, obviously Ertegel was a bit ring rusty, so you'd expect him to come on a lot, but then in the same breath, you're also expecting more improvement from Forrest Waltz.
Yes, I'm hoping Forrest Waltz is... I didn't race him on Super Saturday because he had a slight respiratory infection, nothing serious, but I also didn't want to really wind him up too much because we're hoping to go on to Hong Kong with him as well.
And prayer for relief, Manasseh led. Maf Tool's getting a split. The Guineas winner, Maf Tool, coming through in the centre, has raced up and hit the lead, and Maf Tool is drawing clear. Maf Tool will be too good. Maf Tool first, Cool Cowboy second. Prayer for relief.
Yeah, he's an honest horse. He's 7 years old, so he's also getting on a little bit. Got his aches and pains. He's actually a 1,700 metre horse. He's a very, very... If you look at his form, he's only really one over 1,700 metres. 1,800 seems too far and a mile seems too short. So it's not easy with him. He's a horse that comes under pressure a long way from home and then finishes well. So he gets behind in the dirt. He gets a lot of the kickback. So you've got to really run him wide, because he's, you can't sit him in that kickback and expect him to run on. So he's not an easy horse to ride, because he takes a hell of a ride from a long way out. You know, if he runs a place, it'll be a huge run. It's not a race. It's quite a tough division there too, the mile and the dirt. And you've got to have speed, which he doesn't have. He's a finisher.
It's a long carnival, and we'd like him ready on the end of March. And I think everything he does in between is only, it's all relevant for the big night, because he is a serious World Cup horse.
A serious World Cup horse. That, in the eyes of a man who has gone so close in the race before, is good enough for us.
It's going to be a good race, Andrew. It's going to be very tactical, and probably the best dirt horses around will be in the race. I think Whiptease will be at a peak on the night, but he needs an aggressive ride. You know, last time I thought Christoph was a little soft on him in the first 400 metres. He needed to be aggressive, get him there. There was a hell of a track bias. He was travelling very well into the straight, and then they sprinted away from him. Albeit he wasn't 100%. He's doing very well. He's come down his body weight very well. I think his horse, it'll be in the first four. The one thing about this horse is he can stay. He can stay a mile and a half on the dirt. So, I mean, he's a horse I would not be unhappy to see in front.
The thing that's very exciting about Mubtahish for me is the improvement that he made last year from Super Saturday, when he was right on top of Maftul to Dubai World Cup, which just showed that he really peaked perfectly for the day, which is quite probably what's going to happen this year.
He's going the right way, Andrew. You know, honestly, last time it was, I thought he'd be in the first two. It was a bit disappointing that he finished fourth. But if one looks at the results on the day, you had no chance if you didn't lead on the dirt, on the fence. Nothing got to anybody that led on the fence. For my money, that form won't hold. That was a track bias on the day that I've never, you very rarely see that bad. So I would expect we'll turn that form around and we'll improve on it.
And finally, Mike, there's been talk in the airwaves that there's been a 25% decrease in horses attending the Dubai Carnival. Any reason that you can pinpoint?
Simply the dirt. There's no European horses that go on the dirt, that want to do the dirt.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of us have tried. A lot of European trainers have brought horses there thinking, well, they went at Southall or on the Or, whether they'll give it a crack. They just don't get there. It's they either like it or they hate it. And I think a lot of them don't like it, and that's why I think the fields are not filling. The turf races are very popular.
Yeah.
Hard to get into them, some of them. You know, 100 rated horse, you're getting eliminated. You wouldn't see that in too many countries. So, but the dirt is the cause of the numbers down, that's for sure.
So the void the English horses have left has not been filled by the Americans,
Not at all. It will be filled on World Cup night, certainly. But not in the carnival, no way. I mean, it's, you know, for me, it's something that I said a year ago, we need to embrace, because it is there, it's not going away. And we need to get dirt horses. We're obviously working to change that. Because if you want to be competitive there, you need a dirt horse.
Well, that you said it last year, they must be listening now, surely.
Well, one would hope so. There's a massive gap there in Dubai to be bought out of America.